Good morning and welcome to Praise Cathedral. We want to thank you for tuning into this, our Sunday morning broadcast. I'm here on behalf of our pastor, Bishop Samuel Edward Eigerhart, and we want to let you know today our prayer lines are open. If you need prayer, just call in 210-223-5263. Now, before we start this service, let's go ahead and start off with a scripture, the 100 Psalms. Now, if you would, repeat after me. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pastures. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endure to all generations. And now, the word of God today will be brought to us by none other than our very own Chaplain Timothy Littleton. But before he comes, let's go down memory lane with a song from our choir. Thank you.
want to. You know you want to. So you may as well get up and have your praise break right now. You don't need to wait. You don't need to wait to see what the choir is going to do. It's praise break time right now. Church, and let's go home. Good morning, my friends, on this morning. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you on today for another opportunity to rest by finding peace and comfort in your holy scriptures. We ask you to continue to work on our hearts and our minds, that we may continue to grow and mature as your disciples and reflect an accurate picture of you as we witness to the world. Word my mouth, Father. Hide me behind the cross and let me be found only in your will. In Jesus' name, let the gathered body of believers watching this broadcast on this morning join me in saying amen and amen. Greetings, friends, on this morning. On behalf of my bishop and senior pastor, the Samuel Edward Eigerhart, we thank you for allowing Praise Cathedral to be your choice ministry that you join hands with every week for your spiritual worship. Listen, on this morning, I want to talk very briefly to you about us. The church, you and I, the church. The church is one of the few visible forms of corporate relationship amongst believers. The Bible employs a number of images to describe the church. Among the more important of these images are the people of God, the image of the temple of the Holy Spirit, and the image of the body of Christ. Each image, each picture, each portrait contributes to our understanding and defining of us. The church, who we are, our individual important roles. On today, God wants to deal with us on defining the parameters of us, you and me, as the body of Christ, the church. We're going to focus, yes, on the parameters of us, the church, as the body of Christ. Please go with me to the scriptures found in the book of Revelations, the third chapter. We're going to read together the first through the sixth verse. And it reads, "And to the angel of the church in Sardis write, these things says he who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your works, that you have a name, that you are alive but are dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die, for I have not found your works perfect before God. Remember therefore how you have received and heard. Hold fast and repent. Therefore, if you will not watch, I will come upon you as a thief, and you will not know what hour I will come upon you. You have a few names, even in Sardis, who have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. He who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments, and I will not blot out his name from the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy." I'm speaking to you today concerning us, the church. the body of Christ, us the obligated, us the individual believer, you and I, people who have fully understood that Jesus Christ has bought us with the price of his shed blood on the cross, you constitute, you make up, and you form the body of Christ. In our foundational scriptures on today, we see at the onset, the beginning of Revelations, right after the introduction and the greetings, Jesus gets straight to talking about and addressing the church, his bride-to-be, us, that's you and I. Isn't it intriguing and awe-inspiring that the first topic Jesus reveals of his concerns in this prophetic book is the status of the church, the body of individual believers, the status of you and I? Well, let's talk about the church in Sardis and see, can we hear Christ speaking to us even in the present? Sardis was one of the seven churches that Christ addressed in Revelations. It was located in Asia Minor along a major trade route. And this trade route brought the most populous and influential people to this whole province. But sadly, Sardis was charged by Jesus Christ as being a dead church. Somewhere along the journey of this church, the individual believers begin to overlook their own faults and shortcomings. And when the word of correction, the word of rebuke, the word of right alignment came to their house, they immediately thought that it didn't refer to them. But no church can escape the flaming seeing eyes of the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Verse 1 says, I know your works, that you have a name, that you are alive, but you are dead. It seems that in general, the individual church members of Sardis became great at the profession of religion. Yes, they were proficient at maintaining an outward appearance of being alive. They were good with doing whatever they were doing under the umbrella of the name of Jesus Christ, but spiritually, Lord have mercy, Sardis was dead. The individual believers that constituted that church became spiritually dead. Jesus goes on further and gives solemn direction to the members of this church. He told them to get up and get out of that drowsy state and condition of their church. He told them to strengthen which remain, but which was ready to die. His remedy to these individuals who made up that church was to remember what they had received and hold fast to that which had been communicated to them and repent of all of their sins. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches, you and I, on this morning. Now, it's human nature that our natural defense mechanisms kick in when we perceive something negative directed towards us, and in defense of who we are, we instinctively exclude ourselves from any associations to the charges written in the Holy Scriptures to the church in Sardis. We can so easily exclude ourselves from the all-knowing, all-seeing eyes of Jesus Christ and his warnings. But if we exclude ourselves from this judgment against the church in Sardis, we fall prey to the same logical fallacies that this individual congregation succumbed to at Sardis. Their logic and reason led them to a false, obscured, weakened, ill-sickened relationship with Christ. Instead of assessing themselves, they became comfortable with their reality. They were good to go. They said to themselves, we're not that bad off. They fell prey to their own self-gratifications. But friends and fellow believers everywhere, you must see the inherent danger in easily slipping into a state of spiritual death. Given our global situation, you can easily slip into spiritual death. If we use these revelatory scriptures as our seeing eyeglasses, we can see the global potential of the universal church slipping into the Sardis state of being because we can't physically meet right now. Now, in the light of COVID, do we truly understand God's words when the writer in Hebrews wrote not to forsake the assembly of ourselves together? God, who sees all of history at the same time, knew that there would come such a time as this, that meeting would not be as expedient as it once was. Well, brother preacher, how do I not accidentally or unknowingly slip into a state of spiritual death, as Jesus had charged the church of Sardis? The first thing, my friends, you must understand and permanently accept is your significance and importance to the body of Christ, the church. And second, the importance of staying connected and involved with the body of believers, Christ's church. The Apostle Paul, under the indwellment of the Holy Spirit of God, outdid himself when he painted a picture of the church being likened to that of the human body. He wrote in 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, the 14th through the 20th verse, he wrote this: "For in fact, the body is not one member, but many. If the foot should say, 'Because I am not a hand, I am not of the body,' is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear should say, 'Because I am not an eye, I am not of the body,' is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where would be the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where would be the smelling? But now God has set the members, each one of them, in the body just as he pleases. And if they were all one member, where would the body be? But now indeed, there are many members, yet one body." Listen, this is a good time to type your neighbor and tell your neighbor that there are no useless pieces in the body. Come on up in here. There are no useless pieces in the body of Christ. Listen, I would hate to have to wake up in the morning and to find out that in the middle of the night, when my snoring got a little too bad and my breath began to sour a little bit, that my important tongue, what we use for communication, decided that it's had enough and it can't take anymore, and the tongue said, "I'm out of here," and it's finished. I would hate to have to wake up in the morning and find out that in the middle of the night, when it became the darkest hours and times got a little rough, that both of my legs decided that they would refuse to further be a member of the body and quit operating. I would hate to have to wake up in the morning and find out that in the middle of the night, there was a heavyweight bout between my heart and my lungs, and the heart said to the lungs, "I've had enough of this. You won't quit moving all around, all over the place. So I've decided that I'm going to up and quit." Oh yes, you see the illustration and the analogy that I'm painting on this morning. As a Christian believer, you must understand that the core element of the church is you, the body of believers. Now go ahead and type your neighbor and tell them, "I'm more than just a member." The human body has no useless parts. The church body of Christ has no useless parts. I pray you're understanding what I'm saying on this morning. Just because times are getting rough, don't quit this body of believers. Stay in this house. I said, stay in this house on this morning, Praise Cathedral, and don't quit this body. This is how you avoid the dangers of slipping into spiritual death, by staying connected and plugged in actively to your church. Those of you who are attending other churches and watching this broadcast, don't you fade away from the body of Christ. You stay in your house. This Christian walk was not designated to be solitary and a lone sheep walking by himself in the wilderness will be easy prey and an easy meal for a pack of wolves. Don't you remember the scripture when Jesus installed himself as the first pastor and founder of his new church? Well, let me tell you what happened at that first service. Right after Jesus told Peter and the disciples that he was going to build his church and the gates of hell would not prevail against them, he looked at his first congregants, of that church and preached his first sermon found in Luke, the 22nd chapter at the 31st verse. And it says this, Simon, indeed, Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for you that your faith should not fail. And when you have returned to me, strengthen your brethren. I tell you on today, every member of Praise Cathedral and every member under the matchless name of Jesus Christ, during these unraveling times, Satan has asked God, can he sift you as wheat? Now, we understand that Satan is like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And we've done a good job at identifying when the roaring lion is around and shows up on the scene. But in this scripture, Jesus tells Peter, Satan wants to sift him. Now, this is a more heinous, sinister, diabolical strategy that is revealed. For this type of message is subtle. This method is subtle and it is patient. Satan's method is to surgically and totally remove you from Christ, just a little bit at a time, just a little sift at a time. Don't think for 1 minute that because God is doing his work in the world right now, that Satan isn't trying to take advantage of the situation. Jesus told Peter that Satan desires to sift him as wheat. Don't think for 1 minute that Satan has stopped the sifting method of enticement and luring. Let me tell you something. Satan will sift you from being connected to the church. And he will take full advantage to disable and diminish this house. Satan, that old smooth talker, will sift you away from being connected to the broadcasting platforms that this church is trying to maintain. Satan, that old liar, will sift you away from being connected to the Tuesday night Bible band and Bible study. Not only because he know it will stagnate the refreshing wisdom and knowledge of God, but Satan knows that your absence will begin to psychologically anesthetize your mind and rip away your connectiveness to the family of believers. Satan, the accuser of the brethren, will sift you away from being connected to the Wednesday night prayer line because he knows he don't want you to talk to your Lord and Savior. Satan, the enemy of God, will sift you away from being connected to the Sunday morning live broadcast because he knows if he can get you to stop meeting at the same time, your pattern of obligatory meeting and worship will be thrown into a chaotic disarray, further anesthetizing your spiritual connectiveness to this house. Satan the tempter will ever so softly and ever so gently sift you away until you are completely euthanized and killed off spiritually. And I tell you this morning, church, stay in this house. Get back here and get visible. Your presence is power. The power shared simply by us being together. Don't try to slip away from here and walk this journey on your own. Now is not the time to fade off into obscurity. The church is a living organism. And the collective church can't fulfill its mission in the world without you. Well, how so, preacher? If one voice, your voice, is missing from our singing, our collective singing is a little bit out of tune. If your smile is missing from the hospitality board, I tell you on this morning, it seems that it's a little less hospitable. If your worship is missing from the collective worship, our collective worship isn't as collective as if you were here, all because you were missing. I know you thought that your presence and your participation didn't make any difference, but if one member slides into the background, fades off into obscurity, removes themselves, that's one less organ for the entire body of believers. Just as the human body can survive with one kidney, the overall capabilities of the whole body is greater greatly diminished. Well, what if another vital organ decides that it's going to quit its functions and slide off into obscurity and become absent without leave? That same body, the same body that was once strong and vibrant, the same body that was once brilliant, shining, and a light for the community will be rendered combat ineffective. So I tell you on this morning, church, get back to this house. Stay in this house. Your presence and your active fellowship is my joy. And all of that should be your joy also. This is the joy of connectiveness that the Lord gives us here on this earth. And if that's the joy he gives us, that joy by default becomes our strength. So get back to this house, because I need you and you need me. Our spiritual vitality depends on it. Friends, how can you receive a fresh word without staying connected to the church, without staying connected to the house? I hear someone saying, well, I can log on somewhere else and get a fresh word, but I caution you and say, be careful from eating out so much. Make sure that you understand the best, healthiest meals are prepared for you here, right here in this house. Stay in this house. Let's draw ourselves back in and refresh our spiritual connection to the body of believers and to the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's recommit ourselves to the cause of Christ on this morning. Let's purpose in our hearts that no matter how God works this COVID-19 thing out in our temporary separation, we're going to stand with God and we're going to stand in his will and we're going to be his light to this fallen world. My friends, on this morning, if you are not a part of a house, if you're not part of a fellowship, a body of believers, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, or if you desire forgiveness and restoration, please repeat this prayer after me. Lord Jesus, forgive me of all my sins. I believe that you died on the cross, were buried, and on the third day, God the Father raised you from the dead. Right now, Lord Jesus, I open the door of my heart and I receive you into my heart as my Lord and Savior. Amen. Listen, I say to you, may God's Holy Ghost fire continue to burn as an inferno in your heart until the day that he returns. Stay in this house. God bless you.
Wow, what a powerful, powerful message. If you prayed that prayer and you believe that God has done something to you, feel free, give us a call. Let us talk with you. The number is 210-223-5263. And remember, we are a locally supported congregation. And if you could, go ahead, continue to support us by Givelify or Cash App, which are here on the screen. Just follow the directions. And now, on behalf of our pastor and bishop, we want to thank you for staying with us to the end of this program. And as before, we want to let you know every seed needs a good place to be planted. So try us here at Praise Cathedral. We are the loving, caring, and sharing church. Until next time, stay safe and be blessed.